Hi, I'm Alex McColgan, and you're watching Astrum. Hubble has released a zip file on their website containing the top 100 pictures Hubble has ever taken. What I will do over the course of this series is go through these pictures one by one and explain what it is you're looking at. And believe me, some of these pictures require an explanation. Episode 5. For the episode playlist, click on the annotation here or have a look in the description. Number 28, Doradus 30, or the Tarantula Nebula. This image is a small section of what is known as the Tarantula Nebula. The Tarantula Nebula is a huge, impressive nebula found in the Large Magellanic Cloud, a satellite galaxy to our own. Some may argue it isn't as pretty as some of the other nebula we've looked at so far, but I must say it does look good in its own right. But if it isn't its looks that make this nebula stand out, what is it and what sets it apart from anything we've looked at so far? Well, we'll come back to that. Let's first of all give you some context. So where is it? Well, this is the Large Magellanic Cloud, the largest of the Milky Way satellite galaxies, and as you see, it has a lot of nebula. The one we're focusing on, the Tarantula Nebula, is the brightest and biggest nebula in this galaxy. And it really is bright. I selected this image because it still shows some of its details. Most other images I found show it as this bright, overexposed spot. It's so bright that if this nebula was as close to us as the Orion Nebula in our own Milky Way, it would cast shadows at night. Let's zoom in to find out why. The Tarantula Nebula is currently undergoing extreme star formation. In fact, it's the most active star forming region in the whole local cluster of galaxies. To its center is a region of stars known as NGC 2070. The central concentration of stars known as R136. It's this star cluster that produces most of the energy to make this nebula visible. It's a really big cluster, with an estimated 450,000 solar masses contained within it. Now, if you've ever wondered what the most massive and brightest known star was, look no further. One of the stars in this cluster, known as R136A1, is the most massive and brightest star on record, with some pretty incredible statistics. It's a Wolf-Rayet star, 315 times the mass of the Sun, and 8.7 million times more luminous. It is also one of the hottest stars at 53,000 degrees. While it is the most massive star, it isn't the biggest, although its size still dwarfs the Sun. As always with these massive stars, it will only be short-lived, and it will almost certainly become a black hole at the end of its life. In the meantime, it's shedding its mass through solar wind at a very fast rate. Since its birth, it's thought it's already lost 50 solar masses to space. Overall, the R136 star cluster is thought to be only about 2 million years old. It's currently merging with another close-by cluster, the two clusters together making up NGC 2070. You may not think that there are enough stars in this image to make up 450,000 solar masses, but these blue stars you see in this image are only the very brightest O-type stars in the cluster. Interestingly, there is a star that belongs to this cluster, which isn't found anywhere in the area. If we zoom out a bit, you'll find this star over here. It's called 30 Doradus 016, and the young star, only 1 to 2 million years old, may have traveled about 375 light years from its suspected home in the star cluster R136, and it's still traveling about 400,000 kilometers per hour. But how did it get all the way out here? The theory is that it was part of a binary star system when another, even more massive star entered the system and kicked out the now homeless star. These other stars would have had to have been extremely massive, as 30 Doradus 016 is no minnow at a suspected 90 solar masses. It is now an explorer destined to travel the far reaches of the Large Magellanic Cloud. There is another old star cluster found in the Tarantula Nebula called Hodge 301. It is roughly 20 million years old, with some stars 10 times as old as those found in R136. Within this star cluster, there are thought to have been at least 40 stars that have gone supernova, whereas in R136 there have been none. This is because of the age of Hodge 301. Some of the shortest lived stars have already gone through their entire life cycle. More stars in this cluster are on the verge of exploding in a supernova too, so watch this space. The original image we looked at is further away still from the center of the Tarantula Nebula, although it's still part of it, in an area called NGC 2060, found over here. It's a star cluster too, although the stars here are much more loosely dispersed than in R136 and Hodge 301. In fact, these stars are no longer gravitationally bound to each other, and in a few million years, the stellar group will disperse completely. It's currently about 10 million years old, and there are some very interesting things found in this area. The first I'll mention is that the whole of NGC 2060 is a supernova remnant, about 165 light years across. It's estimated that the supernova occurred about 4,000 to 5,000 years ago, and consistent with this theory, a pulsar neutron star is found in this area here around the same age as the supernova. It's not really visible in visible light, as it emits X-rays, which means you need the X-ray telescope Chandra to see it, and it's right in the middle of this bubble. The bubble itself is the supernova remnant. The pulsar rotates exceptionally fast, once every 16 milliseconds. Interestingly, it's not the fastest rotating star in this region. That accolade belongs to this runaway blue supergiant, VFTS-102. It's actually the fastest rotating star that we know of, rotating a speedy 2 million kilometers per hour. This is 100 times faster than the rotational speed of our sun. It spins so fast that the star is flattened, with an equatorial disk extending out due to centrifugal forces. It is suspected that this runaway star actually was part of the same system as the pulsar and would have had a hand in its supernova explosion. Before the supernova, they would have been two blue stars orbiting one another. One would have evolved into a red supergiant, and as it expanded, it would have started feeding its mass into the other star, speeding the rotation of the other. Once the red supergiant exploded in a supernova, it ejected the other star at a tremendous speed into space. VFTS-102 fits this model as it's spinning rapidly, whilst also hurtling through space in relation to its stellar neighbourhood. Zooming out further again, we are getting to the edge of the Tarantula Nebula. At its longest points, the Tarantula Nebula is an incredible 1,000 light years across. I already mentioned this nebula is the most active star-forming nebula, known as an H2 region, in our local cluster of galaxies, but it is also the biggest. If it was as close to us as the Orion Nebula, it would be twice as big in the sky as the Big Dipper, and because it's so bright, it would even be visible during the day. At the far edge of this nebula is perhaps its most remarkable visual spectacle. It's called SN 1987A, and it's a supernova remnant. It is a lot younger than any of the other supernova we've looked at so far. In fact, it's less than 30 years old. The light from this supernova hit Earth in 1987 and was visible to the naked eye. It was the first supernova observed since the 1600s, and the only supernova observed that we've had a close look at using modern-day telescopes. When it exploded, it was a blue supergiant, which means it was only about 1/10 of the brightness of a red supergiant supernova. Having had the chance to look at it now, I bet you're wondering what these rings could be. Well, they are the mass thrown off by the star through stellar winds, coughing and spluttering its innards out thousands of years before the supernova. The initial flash from the explosion lit the rings up at first, but when the supernova's shockwave hit them a few years later, they lit up again due to interactions with the rings and the debris from the shockwave. SN 1987A is now a true supernova remnant. in the vein of Cassiopeia A, illuminated not by the explosion of the star, but by continual processes between the debris of the supernova and the material beyond it. This artist's illustration of SN 1987A is based on real data and reveals the cold inner regions of the exploded star's remnants, this patch here in red, where tremendous amounts of dust were detected and imaged by the ALMA telescope. It's in this dust that the leftover pulsar could be hiding, because nothing has been detected where the pulsar should be. Another option could be that it didn't turn into a pulsar at all, but is actually now a black hole. Well, that's it for this week. I hope you've enjoyed learning all the interesting facts about the Tarantula Nebula. I was going to do more than one subject this episode, but I just kept finding more and more that I could talk about, and I didn't want to leave anything out. If you enjoyed it, it would mean a lot to me if you could like and share the video. Also, I would like to give a big shout out to my first patrons, Garth Vater and Servando. Thank you so much for your support, it's hugely appreciated. And to all my subscribers, a big thank you and a shout out to you as well. And I'll see you next time.